tonight is visible faith. We are all created in the image of our Father God in heaven. We are made in His likeness. We are body, soul, and spirit. We perceive from the perspective of our body. You have a physical perception of life. What I mean by that is you can perceive hot and cold, wet and dry, right? You do not spiritually perceive the flavors of food. That is a physical perception. Your olfactory glands working in coordination with your taste buds. You taste sweet, sour. You smell the fragrances of the food. So all that's in the body. But we also have a perspective of the soul that has more to do with your emotions and your mind. Your mental perceptions, for instance. You perceive things in your mind that can be even to extremes the fictional character of Sherlock Holmes as written by Sir Arthur Conan Doyle. Is fascinating at his powers of observation, his observational skills to discern and see, and they've made several iterations of some. One I like recently is the one with Lucy Liu in it, as they have a female Watson. How many of you have ever seen that one? With it's very good. What's the name of it? I forgot the name. It's not called Sherlock Holmes. It's called something else. The new Sherlock Holmes with Lucy Liu in it. Elementary, yeah. If you ever get a chance, that's actually really, really well done. And he plays Sherlock Holmes, but in a different paradigm. But anyway, they have perception in my mind, education, and coordination with their physical being. So we can perceive things, we can figure things out by looking at things. Then some things are obvious. But then there are other things that we can perceive by our spirit. And Jesus, of course, had that. We see with the natural eyes, but we also see with spirit eyes. While Jesus was on earth, although he was in a physical form, he perceived things from the perspective of his spirit and soul, primarily his spirit. Because sometimes your soul can lie to you. Sometimes your heart can lie to you. And some people say, well, you know, trust your heart. No, don't trust your heart. You trust the Spirit of the Lord, because even your heart can misguide you. So, well, you just trust, you know, whatever you feel, if it feels good, do that. No, don't trust your feelings either. None of those things. Those are all perceptions that are somewhat applicable, but also easily deceived and misguided. So we need to always be dependent upon the Spirit and the perception of Spirit. Not just the perception of the Holy Spirit, what He tells us, because He can speak to us through discerning of spirits, other things, He can reveal things. But our spirit is created by God, and it bears witness with His Spirit, which means they have the same opinion. This is interesting. If they have the same opinion, it means that they are separate entities. So therefore, our spirit in us, our natural small s spirit, is tuned to the same frequency that the Holy Spirit is tuned to. So whatever the Holy Spirit is discerning and feeling and understanding, our small s spirit will bear witness with that and say, that's right. And so when we discern, it's not just that we are discerning what the Holy Spirit is telling to us, but our spirit man has the ability to perceive things. And this is where a lot of people miss out on living a spiritual life, because they, although we should be completely dependent upon the Holy Spirit, sometimes what they call the Holy Spirit will be awaiting for a certain manifestation or feeling. And when they have that feeling, then they will say, well, now I know because the Spirit is moving. No, you already have the Spirit of God in you, but your spirit has ears. And it says, if he who has ears, let him hear what the Spirit is saying. Well, the Spirit cannot understand anything but Spirit, as the Word says. So therefore, if our ears, what's that that's talking about? Jesus is describing our spiritual ears, our spirit can hear. And so we look at Jesus in the way that he lived in his spiritual complexity, but he discerned things. And the Bible tells us to walk out by faith, not by sight. It says in 2 Corinthians 5:7, for we live by faith, not by sight. So if we examine the passages of Scripture in the Bible that show us Jesus seeing things in spirit and looking at things from a spiritual perspective, we discover interesting patterns that can teach us to reorient our perspective of sight. So if it says we live by faith, not by sight, faith, of course, is something connected to our spirit, Because faith is pistis, faith is something that is eternally born, and it was in existence before, because it says the worlds were framed by it. That means that before anything ever existed, before existence existed, faith was there. And so faith is an eternal component given to us. Where it says that we have eternity in our hearts in Ecclesiastes, I believe it's speaking about that measure of faith that is given to each man. As faith is given to us, eternity is in there. The white light of heaven. And so Jesus walked and lived according to the Spirit. He did walk more accurately in spirit than any human that ever walked the face of the earth. Of course, he was a human just like he was God. He was completely that. Now, I want to divide this message into two parts, asking two questions. What do you see? What are you looking at? When we think about this concerning Jesus, starting with what do you see, we're going to look at some things about Jesus and about his disciples. And I noticed in passages through the years that sometimes they see things I can't see. Now, my earliest recollections of this pattern were actually not so much with me dealing with the Lord, but me dealing with my pastor and my mentor. Because my mentor, Ken Dunbar, my spiritual father, he could see things I couldn't see. Now, I was a brand new Christian, and so just a few years old in the Lord, I would be in a room with him, and I got to actually do like an apprenticeship with him in ministry. So I would see him see things. And it would be so puzzling to me because to him, it was as plain as the nose on his face, as we say, that expression. I know I've been spitting out expressions that people don't know sometimes. What was the one the other day I said, beat the rap? And people were like, huh? That meant like a sentence, a criminal sentence, or you're being persecuted by the police and they're trying to get you, but you beat it and they weren't able to find enough evidence, blah, 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 whatever. That's a lot of explanation. The bottom line is my pastor could see things and I was oblivious to it. He was observant, I was oblivious. And it would be frustrating to him. It was a lot like what we see with Jesus and his disciples. Jesus would explain things to them, it's like this. And they'd go, huh? And he said, look, how is it you have eyes but you can't see? He was telling them that it's so clear. Why can't you see this? How long do I have to be with you people? Look, it's just right there. My mother used to say, another expression, if it had been a snake, it would have bitten you. She used to send me in the kitchen all the time to get things for her. And I don't know who it is. My Sarah Jane does it to me now. I'll send it. Look, go get Daddy. There's a can of Coke Zero in the fridge. I'm really thirsty. Go get it for me. She'll go in there, and like 10 minutes later, all I hear is the fridge door going beep, 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 because it's open. You're like, what are you doing? Hey, Tim, what are you doing? Not you, Tim. It's part of the message. And she would say, I can't find it. And I would go there and like reach forward and touch it. It'd be like right there. That. Oh. That's how I felt with my pastor when I first started discovering the things in the Spirit. He would discern things and he would say right there and I would look around like, what? I remember hearing about a certain minister that was in training. Actually, this was Benny Hinn's brother, Henry Hinn. He came to our church and he shared an interesting message about when his brother, he came under his brother's wing to learn how to minister. It was the same thing with him. He said his brother Benny would tell him, Henry, go, the Spirit is moving. Go quickly to that woman there being touched by God. She's getting healed. Go bring her here. And he would go off and do something else. And Henry would go over there and like he'd not see anything. It was so funny because he told us he'd go to like, there's like 50 people and they're all women. And he'd be like, he said he would go down the line. Are you being healed of cancer? Are you being healed of cancer? He'd like go down the line to one of them. Finally, he would be like still 5-6 people away going down one by one. And his brother would just come over and bam, the lady would fall out healed. And he would walk away and Henry would just walk after. Poor Henry. He was his little brother. You know, he was teaching the ministry, but Henry actually got very good at it. Through Henry Hinn, in fact, came the miracle healing of my grandmother of rheumatoid arthritis. And I saw it with my own eyes. I watched the healing. But anyway, there's things going on in the Spirit that we cannot see until we begin to live a life cultivated. What do you see? The disciples could not see what Jesus saw. Very often, they didn't have a clue. I couldn't see what my pastor was seeing. I couldn't see what my mentor was after. But you know what? After about 7, 8, 9, 10 years, I started seeing things. And then after more time, after the 10 years, in 1995, the Holy Spirit came, he opened my eyes to a whole new level, and then suddenly I was catapulted to a realm of sight that I'd never dreamed possible. But it's like he saw me trying to see in spirit for so long that he finally rewarded me because I never quit. I kept on trying, misprophesying, saying the wrong thing, reading wrong. And believe me, when we read things wrong, we read them really wrong. I have a pastor friend of mine, actually Brother Larry Stockstill, one of the best pastors I ever met. I heard his testimony. He said that he, in his church, you know, they really welcome people of different lifestyles that are in sin so they can preach the gospel to them, but they will not let someone just openly in sin stay in the church for a long time. They have to confront them about that. And he noticed that this couple was coming, and it was two women, and they were very affectionate and seemed to love each other, but crossed some lines. As far now, I'm just telling you what he told me. And so he tolerated it for the longest time. But then they were starting to sit on the front row and hold hands. Then he knew he had to do something about this. So, being a discerning pastor and caring, he called the two women into his office, whereby they said, "Yes, Pastor." He said to them, he says, "Well, I wanted to talk to you about some things, about our doctrines and about what we feel, and I don't want to offend you, but we do not condone lesbianism in our church." And now that's what he said, and they looked at him, and they said that they looked at each other, and they looked at him, and he says, "I'm sorry, I didn't mean to offend you, I'm just telling you that we, and she's, one of the ladies said, "You mean us?" And he said, "Well," and she stood up and said, "She's my mother." They stormed out of the office, never came back. He said, the pastor friend of mine said, it was one of the worst moments of his whole life. It was irredeemable. There was nothing he could do. He's like running after them. Wait. They're like, "No way." They got out of there. So anyway, what does the Bible say? We look through the glass darkly, we see in part. But we're trying, right? We want to see. We want to learn to cultivate our spiritual sight. What do you see? Do you see in the natural? Do you see according to the human perceptions? Do you see according to your heart, to your feelings? Are you biased based upon your knowledge of individuals when it comes to hearing what the Lord is saying about them? A very dangerous pattern is to have an in-house prophet in your church that knows everybody's business. It's amazing how discerning they can become. Well, they know by natural means what's going on in people's lives, right? So they prophesy, or they embellish prophecies because they are tainted, in my words, tainted with ideas about those. It's better to have someone come from the outside that does not know anyone that can be a pure source of divine revelation. In that case, they will see things in spirit because we can easily get confused. But we're learning, we're growing, and Jesus had his disciples and he was teaching them, and he wanted them to be able to develop the same kind of sight, but they were not as quick to see things as he was. And so, what do you see? Let's look at this. Jesus sees the longing of faith. Now, the thing that can be seen, Matthew 9:21, says, "She said to herself, 'If I only touch his cloak, I will be healed.' Now, Jesus turned and saw her. 'Take heart, daughter,' he said. 'Your faith has healed you.' And the woman was healed at that moment." Now, this woman with the issue of blood had a longing that lasted for years. You know the story. That actually, there's another account of this in a different passage that is a lot more explicit and has more details, but I like this one for the sake of my message, because it says Jesus turned and saw her. But you have to ask the question, how did he see her? We know from the other passage that he was in a crowd of people that were pressing all around him. And in fact, in that passage, when he said, "Someone touched me," his disciples said, "What do you mean someone touched you? Everybody's touching." But Jesus knew and perceived. Now, his perception then was, "No, I felt virtue, I felt power go out of me." But in this passage, it just says he saw her. So that means he could see something that is not easily seen with natural eyes. Some people suppose, well, it's because the woman came and repented. No, I think he looked across the crowd and spotted her in that group. And then when he spotted her, then she realized that she was discovered. But I believe that he saw it first. Jesus saw more than just a woman. In other words, the desire or longing that she felt drove her to extremes of faith. But right now we're just talking about the longing. And she said this, if I just touch his cloak. In other words, she had this plan, we know, beforehand. Now, our longing and hope for a remedy to our problems and dilemmas can take us in a number of directions. At first, we may try desperate measures in the natural, but ultimately we find that only God is a source for a miracle, like she did. We know that she spent all her money on doctors. Nothing was there. So in her was a boiling cauldron of expectation or longing for more. And this is something I know. What I'm trying to tell you tonight is one of the reasons why I can see things in the Spirit. I can see longing. I can see desire. I can see sincerity. At this point, after 30 years of doing this, it's as if there is a hat on your head. It'd be like if you looked in this room and one of you were wearing a baseball cap, that's how clear I can see longing, that I can see desire and sincerity. It's like a colored hat on the head of the person. But I conversely can also see insincerity. Not for the sake of judgment, it just becomes apparent to me. I can see incredulity. I can see the doubt, skepticism. I can see by expressions on the face. But I also see longing. And when I see that longing, I know that that person is eligible to do anything, receive anything, and experience anything, but they're in a realm of longing. Now, our job when we're ministering to people is to see that and to use that. Jesus did it again and again and again. He was always ministering to people, and the disciples watched. And Jesus sees our longing. Jesus looks and sees that if you are hungry. Remember, it says that when the Son of Man comes, will he find faith? I believe it shows him. Now, Jesus also sees the action of faith. This is the physical manifestation of the longing. In this passage in Mark chapter 2, verse 4, since they could not get him to Jesus because of the crowd, they made an opening in the roof above Jesus by digging through it and then lowered the mat the man was on or lying on. When Jesus saw their faith, he said to the paralyzed man, "Son, your sins are forgiven." Now here we know that the friends of the paralytic are doing this. This is not something spiritually discerned. This is seeing the actual action. And there's a difference. First you see longing, you see desire, and Jesus demonstrated both. In other words, as I said in the introduction, that Jesus could perceive things in spirit, but he also perceived things in the natural. A lot of people think, well, Zacchaeus up in the tree, he supernaturally knew his name. No, I think probably he asked and found out that his name was Zacchaeus. That's a natural perception. Through a series of interrogative phrases, you can ask questions about somebody and find out things. And then when you get close to them, the perception of the Spirit takes you beyond. The perception of the Spirit encompasses things such as the gift of the word of wisdom and the gift of the word of knowledge. Things that he will tell you about someone, although you may already know. I watch prophets and spiritual people operate. Very often they will say to someone, "What is your name?" "Oh, your name is John." "Okay, John." And then they will start from there just knowing their name, but then they may feel or hear something that the Lord is saying. And they speak along those lines. Well, there's natural and then there's spiritual. Now, sometimes we can get confused. Of course, Jesus never got confused. In this case, he saw their faith, and then he said to the paralyzed man, "Son, your sins are forgiven." So the friends of the paralytic truly wanted to see their friend healed. They had faith enough to bring him to Jesus. Jesus could discernibly see it clearly and react to it. This is like when I say to a room full of people, I'm already discerning longing and desire, but then I put it into an altar call format and ask, how many of you feel? Now, I already know who's feeling. This is what's frustrating to me. How many of you feel the power of God on you right now? And the people who are feeling that, I know, they're not raising their hands. Maybe because of timidity. Whatever the case, they don't want me to pick on them. They're embarrassed. I understand all that. But I can see God's Spirit moving. And I'll say, if God is touching you right now, I want you to raise your hand. They won't raise their hand. I keep going. If God is touching you, you right there, lady in the back. You know, you want to say it that way, but I'm cautious not to be offensive to people. Why? Because I can see the Spirit moving. You say, well, how can you see that? Well, sometimes it's simply by actions of the body. And in the meeting, like I say, there may be people, and I'll say, the Spirit of the Lord is moving over there, and everybody goes, oh, he can discern it. No, I can see somebody shaking. I see drool coming out of the corner of their mouth, and they look like they have cerebral palsy, and they're going into an epileptic fit back there. And I say, the Holy Spirit is moving over there. And people are like, oh, the pastor's so discerning. And I'm like, oh, wow, he's so spiritual. No, the person's about to break a leg back there, flipping around. That's the Holy Spirit. Or I can hear a ruckus or something. If someone's on the floor, I can discern that something supernatural is happening. God is moving over there. And it's interesting to note that when God moves in his zone, that he often will do, it's around that because it is not a mystic concept. It is an actual, it's tantamount to physical when God moves. It happens in pockets and it spreads in that area. And so that also is discernment in the natural, but also from spirit. Now, this is the thing about spiritual discernment, and I didn't quite plan on saying this, but it needs to be said. What is the difference between the natural and the spiritual? The main difference between the natural and the spiritual discernment of the spirit, because you can naturally discern the spirit and you can spiritually discern the spirit, is that the spiritual discernment transcends time. I can sense the move of the Holy Spirit 4 hours before the meeting, because the move does not exist in time. The move exists in eternity because it is a supernatural, eternal component of our lives. But the natural part of it will catch up later on. So, my discernment in spirit tells me as I'm approaching a meeting and I feel certain feelings that are consistent with feelings I felt before actual, factual, experiential, supernatural happenings that I've lived, then 2 + 2 = 4, and I know coming into the meeting, expect something to happen. And so if I expect, I am more sensitive to the action of faith or the visible part of it. Whereas if I hadn't felt that spiritual discernment, I wouldn't have been on my guard waiting. I would have felt like, oh, we just got to get through this service and just let's just worship the Lord. But no, I felt it, so now I'm watching and I'm waiting. Which is also expectation or faith, which is conducive to the very move of the Spirit. So what comes first, the chicken or the egg, the cart or the horse? That's a good question. Because there's supernatural, there is no chronology. They exist simultaneously. And so you feel it. It's just a matter of you yielding to the feelings and then discerning in a natural environment, such as a hole being broken in the roof, that, oh, okay. Because the power of the Lord was present to heal people in that meeting. And that existed before the earth was ever formed. God had already arranged for that to happen. But that roof being broken open, I don't know if that was in heaven's plan. I think that was impromptu, on the spot. Got to do something to make this happen. And so it was really a manifestation of the Spirit, but in natural terms. So we want to look at that, and we want to follow that as an example. And Jesus was teaching his disciples about this. Jesus saw Zacchaeus in the tree. It was not supernatural. I perceive someone's in a tree in the Spirit. No, he knew. But other things he knew by Spirit. But see, also the disciples learned to see the longing of faith. Look at this passage in Acts chapter 3. When he saw Peter and John, who's this? This is the man laid at the gate beautiful. This is the chapter right after the advent of the Spirit or the first baptism of the Holy Spirit. Now they're empowered. And when he saw Peter and John about to enter, he asked them for money. Now, interestingly, it says, and there's no other passage quite like this except for one. It says, Peter looked straight at him, as did John. Now, Peter, John, and all the other disciples and Jesus everywhere throughout the Bible, because I researched it, were constantly confronting and seeing people, but nowhere does it say it quite like this. It specifically says, they looked straight at him, as did John. Peter and John, they looked, and then Peter said, look at us. Why the emphasis on sight? Because if we do not focus with spiritual eyes, even if we don't know what we're doing, if we don't look, we'll miss it. Remember what Elijah told Elisha. If you see it, you will receive it. But if you don't see it, or if you don't see me taken in the fiery chariot, you will not receive the anointing as prophet over Israel. The very thing he spent his life with arrogant Elijah to obtain. He served him, he washed the hands of the man of God, but came down to a simple fact, keep your eyes open and watch, because we become what we behold. You've got to see the Spirit. See the natural, but see the Spirit. You can see it. Well, you say that, but I don't see anything. Well, Peter and John, after 3.5 years of experience watching Jesus perceive and see things, obviously they can see. See things what? Beyond the natural realm. The disciples put what they had learned into practice. So now how many people, do you think that this man at the Gate Beautiful was the only beggar on the streets that day? Now, I envision Jerusalem of that day to be a lot more like India of today. I lived in Mumbai, the largest city in India, and there were beggars everywhere. You can't walk down the street without tripping over 5 or 6 beggars everywhere. They're everywhere all the time. I bet Jerusalem was a lot more like that, that there were people everywhere. So there were others that they did not look at. I remember hearing Smith Wigglesworth talk about this. In his early ministry, he would evangelize extensively, and he said he would go down the street. I read this in his in a biography about him. He would go down the street during peak hours of pedestrian traffic. He would watch the people going to and fro, an ocean of people. But he said he had this saying. He would say he would wait for the one. And when he saw the one, he would move. What was he seeing? What was he looking at? I don't think he means that morning he drew a little sketch of somebody he wanted to see that day with the right kind of hat and mustache and glasses and cane. And he fits the description. So no, I think he was looking, again, talking about spiritual sight. So we need to see. If Jesus taught us this pattern, we can do it. Because obviously Peter and John know. Peter looked straight at him, as did John. Then Peter said, look at us. We're looking at you, you look at us, because for the spiritual interaction that's about to take place, there must be eye contact. We have to look. Now, if you're blind, don't worry. The good thing is you don't need natural eyes to see in spirit. Amen? Amen. You can see in the spirit. And this is not talking about just a natural look. They wanted that connection to be in spirit. Paul saw the longing of faith. Acts chapter 14. We see Peter and John doing it, but now Paul, who was not under the training of Jesus, he also learned it. In Lystra, there sat a man who was lame. This is in Acts 14. He had been that way from birth and had never walked. He listened to Paul as he was preaching. Now, before we go on, I want us to just think about this fact that this man had a problem in his body. From the time he was born, he was an invalid in his ability to walk. He could not move around. He never walked, in fact. Always was not able to walk. And so now he is listening to Paul as he was speaking. What is Paul speaking? Of course, he's speaking about the kingdom. He's speaking kingdom principles. Just like in a church service. In fact, this is just a church service where he's speaking and people are coming to listen. And as he's speaking, this man is listening, but I'm sure that this is not the only man listening. It would have said he spoke to just one man. But it says, in Lystra there sat a man lame, and he'd been that way for this time, and he listened to Paul as he was speaking. But Paul looked directly at him, saw, it says, that he had faith to be healed, and called out, "Stand up on your feet." And that man, at that, the man jumped up and began to walk. So my question is, what did Paul see? Once again, what did he see? Maybe he saw that the man was crippled. That was probably pretty obvious. If you're born your whole life and can't walk, you usually would have atrophied muscle tissue, legs that are small and maybe bent or even tucked under. It would be pretty obvious, well, this person cannot walk. Those legs are too frail. There's no strength in them. But what did he see that made him determine that that man had the faith to be able to receive a miracle? He saw something in the Spirit. So after we learn and grow in Christ and the knowledge of His Holy Spirit, we begin to perceive things beyond the natural. Faith realms and spiritual understandings become normal to us. Now, I'm not preaching this from the perspective of, hey, look, I'm a master, I can see everything, because I'm not there yet. But I'm also a young minister. If you're a burgeoning minister in here tonight, I know that's kind of disappointing to hear that. Well, you said you've been doing this for 30 years. I'll repeat what I said. I'm a young minister. I'm just starting. And after 30 years, I realize I don't know much. And I can't wait to really learn. And it's just beginning. But I have learned to see something. But one thing I know is that every passing year, my sight becomes clearer. And so I'm telling you, begin to focus on the concept of seeing. What do you see? Are you looking with your natural eyes? Are you looking with your human perception? Or are you looking with spirit eyes? Let your small s spirit take the lead in your sight. We walk by faith, not by sight. If you live by the Spirit, that's what you do. Now the second part of this message, what are you looking at? Good question. What are you looking at? Because seeing is one thing. You see something. But looking now is moving more toward what we just saw with Peter and John. But it is more directly looking, and it is a specific word in the Greek separate from see. And so looking through that, I saw there are things that Jesus looked at. We're just going to cover these briefly. Jesus looked up to heaven is one of them. There are several places in the Scripture where it says He looked up to heaven and with a deep sigh said to Him, Ephphatha, which means be opened. And that particular phrase, He was speaking to do a miracle, but He looked up to heaven. Also, in the raising of Lazarus, what does it say in the 41st verse of the 11th chapter of John? So they took away the stone. Then Jesus looked up and said, Father, I thank You that You have heard Me. Now it's interesting to note that there are primarily two things that He's looking at here. Before Jesus did miracles, He often was observed looking up to heaven. Why was He looking up to heaven? Well, I think you know the answer. That the source of the ministry's power of Jesus was heaven. Now I know you're thinking, well, it says from our innermost being will flow forth. Right? Rivers of living water. But do you think you're the origin of the living water? No, I know you don't. We're just the end of the hose. We are that jet on the end with the trigger. That psh, psh. We can stop it. It says, let your peace flow out of you. It says, take your peace back to you. That means that if we are the hose, we have a nozzle that is under our control because the tongues of the prophet are subject to the prophet. And so concerning the anointing flowing out of you, it's under your control. But it is very important that you recognize your source just like Jesus did. Every time Jesus was confronted with a Mac Daddy miracle, the big ones, right? Like raising dead guy, Lazarus, these supernatural things, He would say, okay. He would look up to heaven, maybe make sure His cord was plugged in or something. I'm not saying that Jesus was never not plugged in. I'm just saying that something about the preparation for the miracle required that He check out His connections. And so in this particular case, say, Father, you ready, right? Like, you got my back because I'm about to do something supernatural. And so we see two dimensions here. We see heaven, but we see the Father. He looked up to the Father. He looked up to heaven. We look up. From heaven comes everything. That's where the throne is. That's where the threshold is. That's where the pealings of lightning are coming off. And the rainbow is there throbbing around the origin of living water that is flowing out to us. And when we need it, when we want to do something, it is important that we remember, take note, look up with spiritual eyes. And I often do that. I've learned to see the Father with my eyes. Specifically, you've heard me say, there was a season a couple years back where the Father every day was coming from right here behind me. just off to my left over here. He was. I don't know why, but the thought, I feel the presence of the Father. Now, some people theologically argue with me and say, well, the Father is in heaven, the Spirit is on earth, and Jesus is in his right hand, so the Father can't be down here. It's the Trinity. It's God. The awareness of my Father, that when you pray, your Father who is invisible sees that awareness. It became so keen, and still is to this day, but it was really strong for a while, that I literally would, in my peripheral vision, would keep looking. And whenever I would look back, I would feel a flood of energy from my Father. Feel it physically, and I would start weeping uncontrollably. Day after day after day after day. I still feel it all the time. But that was, it was like he was trying to tell me that, look, I'm right here. That I could see. Father. And if you know me at all, and you know about, when I tell you about, you ask me, you know, how was your morning? If I say the words to you, my Father came. That's what I'm talking about. I'm talking about it. He walked in. And I saw him. Like that. I see now, I know you can't see what I see. But I see the Father. You say, well, I want that. Well, didn't get it. Get it, because it's through discernment. It's through an open heart. It's through a hunger and a desire. The perception gets stronger and stronger. Less you depend on the natural, more you depend on the spiritual. Your spirit grows in strength. Your spirit, it isn't so much that it grows in strength as much as you learn to release your spirit to do what God designed your spirit to do, to sing in perfect harmony with the Holy Ghost, and their voices are beautiful together. When they sing together, when my spirit, the deep calling, the deep, when my spirit, it bears witness with his spirit, it is such beautiful music that is made, and everything becomes wonderful. Communion, spirit with spirit, little s, big s, little s, big spirit, little spirit. And he takes you by the hand. Then, whatever you have to accomplish, whatever you have to do, if it's raising your friend Lazarus from the dead, you can look up and say, Father, I need your help down here. Important. We are exactly like Jesus. We need to understand the source of our power. And it's the Father in heaven. Flowing from his throne is all the power we need to accomplish his will here on earth. Now, we know Jesus looked to heal. I say heal, but really this is just make things right. But that's healing, right? Fix things. Matthew 8:33. By the way, these are the places where it says that Jesus looked. When Jesus turned and looked at his disciples, he rebuked Peter. Get behind me, Satan. Sad day for Peter. Poor Peter. He said, you do not have in mind the concerns of God, but merely human concern. This is, of course, where Peter tried to prohibit Jesus from going to Jerusalem to be crucified. Out of love, out of compassion for his master, I will never let this happen to you. And in doing so, he became the voice of Satan. Satan, that's all Satan ever wanted to do, is stop Jesus from dying on the cross. That was his mission. That's what he wanted to do. Come and just, you know, bow down to me and all this will be yours. Cast yourself from this. All the temptations were to try to derail the mission that began with the baptism of the Holy Spirit, when the Spirit drove him into the wilderness for that time so that God could see, are you going to listen to the devil or are you going to listen to me? Father, I'm sure I had total confidence that Jesus would pass the test. He still had to go through the test. Why? Because he was the firstborn among many brothers, that we are following his example. So we too go through a process. Turn and look at this and say, Mark 3:5, he looked around at them in anger, at people, and deeply distressed at their stubborn hearts, said to the man, stretch out your hand. He stretched it out and his hand was completely restored. We know this is the man that was healed on the Sabbath. Because their heart didn't care that the man could be miraculously healed. They knew Jesus had already done many miracles. And this is what's so pathetic about them and why he's so angry. They'd seen miracles. They knew he could do the miracles. But it didn't matter that this man could be set free. It was more important that you keep the Sabbath holy. Jesus was angry at that. He had every right to be angry at them. He looked at them in anger. So sometimes Jesus looks to bring correction. Correction to them, correction to reorient. And sometimes that's exactly what we see in spirit. God will show you the wrong thing so that you can make it right. You'll see it in the spirit. Recently, a friend of mine said that they went somewhere and they were in a relationship with some people and that they just had a feeling that something was wrong with these certain people. And I said, oh, that's interesting. What happened? Well, I didn't connect with them. And it turned out later that the thing they would have connected to fell apart. Well, thank God for God's warning, right? Their protection. To protect them from getting into trouble, to protect them from those things. God, well, you need to see with the Spirit to be able to do that. God will protect you because it is Jesus' concern to bring correction and to bring it in a way that will protect you. Now, Jesus looked at his disciples as family. Then he looked at those seated in a circle around him and said, here are my mother and my brothers. Now you know the story behind this, that Jesus was being confronted by his family who had come to take him by force because they were so busy they didn't have time to eat. The ministry became so busy that he and the disciples, there's no breakfast, no lunch. It's just miracle after miracle. Preach, pray, prophesy. It was a time of revival. Jesus did not consistently live that way. He often went away to rest and took his disciples with him. He knew how to manage his time, but he also knew when it was on, it was on. When it was hot, it was hot. And when it's not, it's not. Why? Because, once again, he could see and perceive and know what the Father's purposes were. And when it was moving, he was operating in that. Now, it's interesting to note that his family came and thought it was insane and literally thought he'd lost his mind and wanted to take him by force. But he said, I'm not going out there. But I like that he looked at those seated in the circle around him and said, this is my mother and my brothers. That means he looked at them and said, he didn't say, these are like my mother and brothers. They're similar to my brothers. He said, they are. He spoke it. Now, some people say, well, it's just a metaphor. No, I think he saw them as his family. Thank God, because that includes me and you, because right now tonight we're seated in a circle around him. His presence is here. But wouldn't you like the idea that right now the Holy Spirit is looking at you and says, that's my mother and my brothers, that we are included in his family. I know that for a fact. We also can see that way. I see in the Spirit. I see people sometimes, maybe it's the first time I'm ever meeting them, and instantly there's a rapport, and instantly I see them as family. It's strange. That's really what I felt with Suzanne and Matthews when they came the first time. I knew right away. Those people were supposed to, they were family. I felt like immediately, like I was related. Where have you been, my long-lost cousins? And, you know, I felt an instant connect. I saw that in spirit. Now, they also perceived the same thing. I believe they felt the same connection. Maybe they didn't have the same kind of experience I had, but I knew that it was because I've experienced it many times with many other people in other nations. It's so that I could impart in a season all the gifts that God has in me into their lives, which they will absolutely receive and live and move into. Who knows what their future holds? But for now, they're my mothers and my brothers. And I love connecting to people. And I see that in spirit. Now, I see some other people sometimes, and I do not feel that kindredness. I do not feel that connection. No one in this room, by the way. Be careful where my eyes are going, in case you think, oh, he looked at me. Oh, no, everybody in this room I feel a connection to. Jesus looked at us to love and teach. This passage in Mark 10, verse 21. Jesus looked at him and loved him. And this is the rich young ruler who was asking, how do I get into eternal life? And he said, I do all the, because he told him first the commandments. He said, I've done all those since I was a boy. And he says, okay. He looked at him and loved him. One thing you lack, he said, go sell everything you have and give to the poor. And you will have treasure in heaven. Then come, follow me. At this, man's face fell. He went away sad because he had great wealth. Jesus looked around and said to his disciples, how hard it is for the rich to enter the kingdom of God. The disciples were amazed at his words. But Jesus said again, "Children, how hard it is to enter the kingdom of God. It is easier for a camel to go through the eye of a needle than for someone who is rich to enter the kingdom of God." The disciples were even more amazed and said to each other, who then can be saved? Jesus looked at them and said, this is three times Jesus looked at them. With man, this is impossible, but not with God. All things are possible with God. So here we see that in order to teach, Jesus looked at us to love and teach. When you're ministering the word, when you are speaking principles that someone needs to hear, whether they like it or not, because this man did not like it, you look at them in the eyes, you deliver that word, you deliver that message, and the message goes out. Does not mean you love them, you feel the love, but it does not mean they will do what God is saying. I always quote Catherine Coleman, you can sit with someone with all the anointing, the presence of God, and speak all revelation to that person, and tell them the will of God for their lives, and describe it clearly. When they get up, as soon as they go out of that door, they're going to do exactly what they want to do. And that was Catherine's conclusion after a long ministry, many years of counseling in the Holy Spirit, powerful anointing in our life, to people just basically choose to do whatever they want to do. And I understand we all have to work out our own salvation with fear and trembling, but there's times, like in this case, well, could you conclude then, well, it wasn't God's will for him to sell everything and give it to the poor. I don't see that. I see him as missing God's will. Why else would Jesus have said it? Did Jesus just go around telling people to do things and then later said, no, I'm just kidding, that's not God. Peter, go catch a fish, and the first one you catch is going to be a coin. It's not really? No, I'm just kidding. I just want to see if you do it. No. If Jesus said it because it's true, and it was God's will. He didn't do anything that the Father didn't say to do, right? That means he was the only human that ever walked that did completely, always, all the time, the will of the Father. Well, so what about the times he was not able to achieve the things he was supposed to do? It wasn't the Father's fault, and it wasn't Jesus' fault, that was people's fault. They wouldn't receive him in that village. And so sometimes you get confused and think, well, I miss God because it didn't work out. No, sometimes people mess it up. I cannot count on all my fingers and toes the times that people, that God spoke to me to do something, and I stepped out in faith and did everything and lined everything up and had everything ready, and people did not do what they even promised they would do, and it just didn't work out because there was no agreement, and the agreement was broken, and I was left, well, I'll just try something else. The thing is, you just don't quit. Just keep going, just keep going, keep going, keep going. What can you do? God will say it, but everybody has free will. I hate it. I wish I could just control everybody. That would be a great gift if the pastor had the ability to just control everybody. And of course, I'm not going to do that. I don't mean what I'm saying. I just would love to see everybody do the will of the Father. Imagine if we all, imagine if everyone was as heaven-bent, that's a play on another expression, as heaven-bent on accomplishing the Father's will as, I'm going to step out on them as I am. If people were willing to pay the price that I've paid through the years, if everybody was willing to do the same things I've done, there's no end to what we could accomplish. And I've had people come and we've done great things. Of course, they're only with me for a season, and they go out and do great things somewhere else. Because that's the ministry of Jesus, which we're supposed to copy. I'm not looking to hoard a bunch of people into a room and say, look, we've got a church full of people. No, I want a revolving door in anything I ever do. Come, get empowered, get trained, get sent out. Come, get empowered, get trained, get sent out. You go create realms where the same thing can happen. But to do this, we need to be able to see. We need to be able to look. We need spiritual eyes. We need to be able to connect with our disciples. We need to be able to love them and speak. And then people will decide. Visible faith. The Bible tells us to walk by faith and not by sight. We saw that's a fact. How many of you would agree with that? You can walk by sight, which means that you make all your decisions based upon your natural mind. That's walking by sight, what you see. Well, I can analyze the markets to know that if I invest so much into this, this, and this, then that will be a deal. There's something to be said about using wisdom concerning your resources, which are your life. The life is not constituted of what a man owns, but we know that it's part and parcel of your existence, your custodianship over the things you have. You are steward. But God gives us opportunities to be a part of something. But sometimes we make all of our choices not by spirit, but by the flesh, by the natural, by feelings, which would be also another form of soul, but not always spirit. Because the spirit will very often be radically, conversely different from what your soul tells you and what your mind tells you, or what your heart tells you, what feels right, looks right, what smells right, tastes right, must be right. Wrong answer. The spirit will still say no. It won't make any sense to you sometimes. That's walking by faith and not by sight. So how do we do that? Well, we have to see something other. What is that? What do you see? Well, Jesus saw the longing of faith. Jesus saw the action of faith, just like we do. He sees it in us too. The disciples learned to see the longing of faith, and Paul saw the longing of faith. So Peter, John, Paul, the superheroes of the New Testament, outside of Jesus, they depended on what this. We saw them seeing things that makes no sense in the natural. They just saw it. Jesus, it said in other places that he simply perceived. He perceived that they were thinking things. That's just an extension of spiritual sight. He just knew what was in their hearts. He always knew what was in their hearts. He didn't need any man to teach him about man because he knew what was in man. That's why he didn't commit himself to men. And he was very cautious, because he had only spiritual sight. But he also saw that the fig tree didn't have fruit with natural eyes, and he cursed it to death. So he also was natural. But what are you looking at? Well, Jesus looked up to heaven. Are you looking up to heaven? That's where, if you can develop eyes to see heaven, you can see any heavenly things on earth. Understand? If you develop eyes to see heaven, what do you mean by that? I mean visualizing the throne, visualizing the Lamb of God, visualizing the Father, visualizing that river. I believe God will even allow you to use your creative thought to just come up with an idea, whatever helps you connect in the way that you see in spirit. We don't know. We see in part. We will not see totally accurately, but we got to at least try to see the best we can. If you can get a vision for heaven, then you will see the heavenly aspect on earth. You understand? You will see spirit things. If you, through worship, know how to connect to the throne and perceive and see, and I've had encounters with God's throne that are overwhelming. Things I've seen, things I've heard, things that are beyond my comprehension or my ability to even describe adequately. I can't figure out. One time, I was caught up to a place in worship, and suddenly it was like he just turned a television screen on in front of me, and I saw and felt and perceived, and God just started talking to me. I don't know why I did this. It was actually a retreat that we had when we were connected with Pastor Paul of Yen. And I just suddenly, I'm just worshiping, and I, bam, I'm standing there seeing what's going on in heaven. It was overwhelming. And I saw and described to people. And what's funny is later I asked, I want to hear that tape. I was incoherent. Mm-hmm. I heard recordings of me trying to describe. I was like, like I couldn't even understand what I was saying. And the scripture made sense to me. Eye has not seen. It can't enter. I tried. What did Paul say? Things that can't be uttered. I heard things uttered that I cannot speak on earth. When I was in that state of vision, I tried to describe some of the things I was able to describe, but he was showing me so much, and I was babbling. I was like, I was like that one time in the meeting, one of the most embarrassing things that happened to me. I had been following the ministry of Dr. Rodney Brown for quite a while. I had not met him. And finally my chance came. to meet and talk to Rodney R. Brown, called me up in his meeting in front of a few thousand people and asked me questions. And so I walked straight up to him, and I was totally in my right mind when I did so. And he said, "Where are you from?" And I said, "Bleh." That's what I said. "Bleh." And he said, "Hallelujah. What's your name, brother?" And I said, And I remember thinking, "What is wrong? I can't talk." And he said, "Who has brought him here tonight?" Whereby Barbara ran up quickly behind me. I'm his wife. And as far as he knows, I am the mentally challenged man being escorted by his helper. Because everything the man asked now, and then I was so upset I couldn't talk, I started crying. And he's like, "Oh, poor guy." And I'm so embarrassed. I'm like, "No, why would the Lord do that?" And my wife was interpreting. And she told him, "Well, actually, Brother Rodney, you have to know that we are great admirers of your ministry." She was totally coherent. And I was just going, you know, I was like, "Give me the writing pad." I was like Zechariah before, you know, God in the temple, and he took my ability to talk away. My God. Places in spirit. Because when you go into certain spiritual realms, your natural just falls apart. I think we've all experienced it to a certain degree. Perception in spirit. But anyway, back to what I was trying to say, and I'm actually trying to close with the story. That what I saw in heaven was amazing. That it was, it's so hard to describe it. I see it right now in my head, but I still can't really describe it. I'll put it like this. So I get tongue-tied. Senses are intermingled. We have kinesthesia. If you know what that is, it's a mixing of senses. Some people can smell colors. Some people can taste colors. Some people, like, it's a rare occasion, some people have this thing. There, all senses are mingled. You can feel sound. Another thing that I saw while I was there. How many of you like to sing? Maybe you don't have the best voice, but you always wished, "I wish I could really sing." You are going to be so blessed in heaven. All of us have this. It's like a 12 or 15 octave range. It goes beyond human hearing in both directions. Instantly we can sing in noises and sounds, and when we sing colors, it meant we sing colors. The rainbow, he showed me, is an amassing of the worship of the saints that collects around the throne. It's beautiful, so beautiful beyond anything you could possibly comprehend. My point is, if you ask the Lord to show you heaven, when you start to see and taste and know even the bewildering, mind-boggling things of that place, down here in the squalor of time, in this cesspool that we live in, you see heaven's components like pieces of gold, like diamonds. It's so beautiful. When I see people being touched by the Lord, it's all I see. When I see the Holy Spirit moving in someone, I see the light. I see the lights that I saw there. And I know there's a connect that is not, it's out of this place, and because it's not bound, as I see streams of heaven's light. It says a river, but it's not flowing like we earthly water will flow. It is, but it isn't. It can be like we see a beam of light. When heaven connects to individuals, it looks more like the laser beam in a science fiction. It's instant and direct. There's not even a perceivable motion to it. It's instant. Like light travels, so does the glory of God. And it moves and touches. God wants us to see. God wants us to perceive in spirit. He wants us to see like Jesus saw. And He can open your eyes.